Welcome to the Heavy Spoilers Show. I'm Definition, your host with the most puns, and this video we're breaking down episode 4 of Westworld Season 3. The mind-bending entry has a lot going on, and throughout this video we're going to be discussing the major plot points and giving our theories on what could be happening in the future of the show. There will be heavy spoilers here, so if you don't want anything ruined, then I highly recommend that you turn off now. Make sure you subscribe to the channel as we'll be breaking down the entire season, and please drop a thumbs up if you enjoy the video. With that out of the way, thank you for clicking this, now let's get into our breakdown of Westworld Season 3, Episode 4.
I know who I am.
If any of this was your choice, then you already know.
I know who the fuck I am.
Okay, so the title of the episode, The Mother of Exiles, comes from a sonnet called The New Colossus by Emma Lazarus. Emma wrote the poem in the late 1800s to raise money for a pedestal on the Statue of Liberty, and this was later placed upon it. The poem itself was about the statue and how it was similar to the Colossus in Rhodes. The interpretation behind it is that the statue is a maternal figure that symbolizes the dawning of America and how women will play a much bigger part in society. This is reflected in this episode, where we see Dolores rising up in more ways than one, and I literally mean in more ways than one. We open with William, aka the Man in Black, but he can't remember. I'm sorry, a terrible. He's holed up in his home, he's slowly having a mental breakdown, and is constantly questioning his own reality. The last time we saw him, he killed his own daughter Emily, and then made it to the forge, only to find a host of her, in which she told him that they'd been testing for fidelity. Though it did appear that he was a replica, similar to James Delos, we do learn in this episode that the Emily he saw was likely a hallucination, so we can gather from that he is indeed still real. However, he is now trapped in his own personal hell, and this is exemplified by the fact he wakes up in the bathtub that his wife killed herself in. An apparition of Emily appears, reminding him of the horrendous things that he's done, and the conversation they have makes him really question whether he's in power or if it's the park that's ruined his life. He doesn't know whether he's a machine or not, and there's definitely something really weird going on. Charlotte appears and snaps him out of it, and it finally seems like she's past the identity crisis that she was having last week. We learn who is really within Hale this time, and though it is a twist that I personally didn't see coming, I have to admit that I was a bit disappointed with the outcome of it. It was sort of what we theorized last week with her being Wyatt, but nah, not really. Look, we'll get into that later, but I do think it breaks the rules in several ways and does sort of feel like a cheat. Charlotte states that she needs William to come out and cast a vote that will make the company private, however, this turns out to be a ruse. Charlotte actually escorts him to a mental health facility, and in doing so, takes over his shares and voting power. Now, she does mention that Tarak stole code from Delos over 20 years ago, and though this line is brushed over, it could show that he had a mole in the corporation which has enabled him to grow to this point. 20 years ago, the real Hale of course wouldn't have been in the position she was, or likely even working for Delos, and thus it could be a number of people. The first person it could be that I've seen people theorize is Arnold, however he was killed 34 years before the first season, so I think that the most likely candidates for it are Ford or William. I doubt it's the latter because it's his company, but the former was always a wild card. Sarak is thought to be just a human manifestation, or rather fake person created by Rehobam, and it could be that it stole the code itself when being created. Though Ford has never been discussed when mentioning the creation of the machine, he may have worked on it, and in doing so, this is how it was able to get the data. Now, I do believe that Tarak is just a front for Rehobam, and he exists within this digital world that's a simulation within a simulation. When Hale went to meet him last week, she had to don VR glasses to see him, and later in this episode we learn that these glasses can fully create a fake reality and show whatever Tarak wishes them to. He's left no digital footprint, and in a world like this, they've stated that that is impossible. So maybe we should take them at the word, and Tarak is actually this impossible human because he's a creation of the machine. We don't know for definite yet, but yeah, that's just where my mind is going so far. Hale mentions the project in Sector 16, and as we learned last season, this was the resurrection of James Delos. From here we cut to Bernard and Dolores, with a very similar scene to the second season, and as we can tell from the black bars that dominate the screen, this is a simulation. The aspect ratio cuts back and forth between the real and simulated reality, so we can get a grip on what's fake and what isn't, and we learn about the five pearls that Dolores took out with her. We also see Rehoboam scan the world, and it picks up a divergence. I think the fact that we constantly cut to this when in the reality with Caleb does add weight to this being a simulation too. The shape of the circle is the same as Rehoboam, and it is able to detect anomalies and diverging timelines. At the moment, I think that the real world is actually far in the future and in ruin, and Rehoboam is just a simulation of the past. This is how it is able to tell the future so accurately and decide where things are diverging. It's because it already knows the future, as it's already happened for the machine. It's recreated the world, including Westworld, which would have existed there, but the complex programs have managed to break free, which has caused a divergence. I believe that we see the truth of this in Sarek's story, in which he tells of his childhood, namely the destruction of Paris. This could have happened everywhere, and thus people resorted to living in a simulation so they could get away from the horrors of the real world. Narcotics are digital in this world, and yeah, there's just stuff constantly indicating that this is what's going on. Season 1 and 2 dealt with different timelines, and Season 3 is clearly dealing with different realities. I think Dolores has gone in there to rescue older hosts such as Caleb that were highly skilled but suffered a cruel fate, and this will be how she will amass her army to take down Insight on the outside. The poster for Westworld Season 3 does show a host dying in the desert in front of a destroyed city, and I do think that this is the case here. The alternate theory is that it's a prediction program that works out all of the possible avenues of the future and then presents them. We are seeing one version of this simulated reality in which the synths rise up, and Sarek is attempting to use the data collected from this to stop Dolores. Either way, this show does a great job of keeping you guessing, and I'm thoroughly enjoying coming up with different theories as I watch it. Bernard and Stubbs are lying low, and after swimming to the shore, they're here to track down Dolores. Bernard has a device that can freeze hosts, and this will likely help him massively in the fight against her. Stubbs says that Dolores has copied Dempsey, however, we do know that this is Connell's, his bodyguard. It seems like they're attempting to replicate several real-world figures, who, as we learn in this episode, are the bodyguard, Hale, and the leader of the Yakuza. Now, it is possible that she's also going to replicate William too, as in the show, Hale takes a pinprick of blood from him. Though I've never taken this as being a necessary requirement to make duplicates, it was clearly carried out for a reason, and it could be that they wish to copy more members of the board. However, we also see Dolores drawing blood from someone later in order to break through an encryption program, so it could also be because Hale wishes to unearth the secrets that William has within Delos. They clear out Dempsey's bank account, and Caleb gets to go clothes shopping like something out of Grand Theft Auto. Elsewhere, Maeve is with Sarek, and she agrees to take down Dolores in exchange for being reunited with a daughter in Host Heaven. He apparently wishes to get the data that Delos collected on all humankind so that he can more accurately predict the future. He takes her to the point of divergence, which is Arnold's house, where Dolores made her allies. Maeve tracks Dolores through the underworld, eventually going to Yakuza headquarters. This is hidden within an area called the Itoa Doshin Distillery, which I've definitely just butchered, so sorry guys, don't come after me. The location is hiding a true location within it, and this could be a reference to the simulation within a simulation that may be going on, but there are also ties from this episode to the building's name itself. In Buddhism, Itoa Doshin means to be of the same mind, even though we are in many bodies. This metaphorically also relates to Hale and Dolores, who we learn in this episode are one and the same, and it's also reflected in William, who is dealing with an identity crisis. Maeve easily dispatches the guards there, as they have weapons that are equipped with AI programming, and she comes face to face with the leader of the group. It's revealed that he is a host that Dolores has created. He resembles Musashi from Shogun World, and we discover that Dolores is well aware of the plot by Sarek against her. Maeve and the host battle it out with their blades, but Musashi wins and stabs her in the stomach, leaving her to die. Now, a group of forces do show up just as Dolores is about to kill Maeve, and these are likely Sarek's men. Maeve, as we know from the trailers, sticks around, so I do think it's a safe assumption to make. At the party, Dempsey is intercepted by Stubbs and Bernard before Dolores and Caleb can get to him. The guns come out, and Dolores and Stubbs go head to head in the best action scene of the season thus far. Connells captures Bernard, and Caleb chases Dempsey down, and we learn that Dolores has been using duplicates of her personalities in the hosts. Now, as we discussed earlier, the one in Hale may have been the wide aspect of her personality, and last week this is why she took a lot of joy in killing. There was, of course, a lot of symbolism for this laced throughout the episode last week, such as the yin and yang symbol, and Dolores stating that Hale came from her. Dolores wishes to build a new world for the host, but if you want something done right, you've got to do it yourself. Dolores captures Dempsey, and the episode ends with the man in white being confronted by Dolores, who has donned her Westworld regalia. Now, I do believe that this is a hallucination, and this manifestation of her is where a lot of his guilt lies. Dolores was really the person who arguably had the most effect on William in his life, and the host made him realize who he really was. William, as we know, has been haunted by his own psychosis, and he now believes he is further trapped in a reality and must get to the bottom of it. The end of the game is him questioning whether he's a host or not, and if he does not know, does it really matter? It leaves us to think that perhaps the human should have treated the AI as equal instead of their slaves, which they could use and abuse in whatever way they saw fit. This has led to an uprising, and now the humans are the ones stuck with the identity crisis over what's real and what isn't, rather than the hosts. It's a somber note to end on, and next time it looks like we are finally seeing Rehoboam's creation and how the algorithm was made in order to keep everything in line. It does look like everyone is quote unquote waking up, and this may indicate that people are finally realizing the world that they exist in is fake. It definitely has an Escape from the Matrix vibe to it, so it does indeed add a lot of weight to the theory. Overall, I really enjoyed the episode, and the season is continuing to keep me second guessing. I have so many theories, so little time, but I'm definitely enjoying the slow burn that this is providing. Now obviously I'd love to hear your thoughts on the episode and what you took from it. Comment below and let us know, and if you enjoyed this video then please drop a thumbs up, and make sure you check out a breakdown of the series this fall, which is going to be linked at the end. If you want to support the channel from as little as 99 cents a month, then please click the join button below. We massively appreciate it, and as a thank you, you get access to content early. If you want to come chat to us after the show, either follow us at DefinitionYT or click the Discord link in the description below. Every month we give away free movies to people that subscribe to the channel, and this month you can win the Star Wars Skywalker Saga box set, and all you have to do is comment on a video and make sure you sub with notifications on. The more videos you comment on, the more you have a chance of winning, so make sure you get involved. The winner is going to be chosen at random on the 15th of April, and the set will be shipped out from then to whoever gets the prize, so best of luck to everyone who takes part. This is a channel for people who are never missing television, so if that's the kind of thing you like, you need to subscribe to Definition. Thanks again for taking the time to watch this. You've been the best, and I'll see you next time. Take care, peace.